Hi everyone, welcome to Unit 5 of the Water Accounting using WAPOR module. This is the last unit of the module. In the previous units, we have discussed several aspects of water accounting, starting from its definition to the relevance of water accounting to integrated water resources management. We covered water balance of a river basin, the type of data sets we use for water accounting, and how we can validate this data. We have also discussed about green and blue components of evapotranspiration. In this last unit, we will discuss about water accounting report. We will see the resource-based sheet in detail, the maps and the tables accompanying the water accounting report, and the key indicators of water resources situation of a river basin derived from water accounting analysis. After following this unit, you will be able to describe the resource-based sheet of the water accounting report, describe the tables and maps accompanying the water accounting report, describe the key indicators of water resource situation of a river basin, and calculate the key indicators. If you remember from Unit 2, we have seen that the purpose of the resource-based sheet is to provide general overview at a river basin scale on the inflows and outflows, manageable and unmanageable flows, utilized and utilizable flows, and it also evaluates the different sources of water that contributes to net inflow. It also distinguishes between landscape evapotranspiration and incremental evapotranspiration by natural and man-made withdrawals, and it helps us to understand the role of water storage on water availability. We have said that the resource-based sheet provides general overview of the water resource situation of a river basin. But what are the numbers in the sheet representing? Let us see them one by one. Starting from the title block, it shows the name of the sheet. Of course, it is the resource-based sheet. It shows the name of the river basin for which the sheet is developed for, and it shows the period covered by the analysis and the unit. Some basins are big enough to have the unit in cubic kilometer per year. For small basins, the unit could be million cubic meter per year. Inflows to the basin. Precipitation is the main inflow component. A river basin could have inflows from desalination. Water can be brought from other basins artificially through basin transfer. There may also be groundwater inflow to the basin from other basins. The groundwater basin could be different from the surface boundary of a river basin. The sum of all these inflows will add up to get the external inflow to the basin. Water may be abstracted or added to the storage within the basin. Therefore, the gross inflow will be the sum of the external inflow and the change in storage. The net inflow represents the net amount of water available for consumption. This net inflow will partly be consumed by the landscape evapotranspiration and partly be available for exploitation. Part of the exploitable water be consumed by incremental evapotranspiration of managed water uses, such as irrigation, and the remaining, if there is some left, will be considered as non-consumed water. The water consumed by evapotranspiration is divided into rainfall and incremental components. The landscape evapotranspiration, which is the sum of rainfall evapotranspiration of all land use types and incremental evapotranspiration of protected land use, utilized land use, and managed land use, is the evapotranspiration occurring naturally. The consumed water is all the water consumed by evapotranspiration. And the difference between net inflow and consumed water is the non-consumed water, which can be further divided into different types of outflows from the basin. The surface outflow is the surface outflow from the basin occurring naturally. There could also be artificial surface outflow in the form of basin transfer and groundwater outflow occurring at the subsurface. All these outflows and the consumption are going out of the river basin. Sheet 1 provides an overview of the water resources and its current utilization per different land use categories. However, all the values expressed are averaged over the basin. We need also to show the spatial variability of precipitation, evapotranspiration, and their differences, temporal variation in the form of mean, monthly, and annual values, and the consumption per water accounting plus land use categories and per land cover categories. To show spatial and temporal variabilities, we use different maps, figures, and tables. A reporting structure may be based on personal interest from the people or organization compiling the report, or the client interest, or both. However, the water accounting report should include the following basic sections. It should include executive summary, introduction, methodology, data analysis and results, and conclusions. The introduction part of the report at least should include information on the river basin, the water resources situation, present and past water resource development activities and challenges, and the objectives of the water accounting study. Why, for whom, and who has carried out the water accounting study. The methodology part should include the methodology followed to produce the water accounts, the data types and sources used for the analysis, and validation carried out to validate the data used. The data analysis and the results part should include an overview of the water accounts for the analysis period, variability of the water accounts during the period, analysis of water accounts for dry and wet situation within the analysis period. It should also include the analysis of key indicators of the water resource situation for the analysis period. We will see the key indicators in the following slides. The conclusion part of the report summarizes the water resource situations of the basin by briefly discussing main findings or significant results in relation to the objectives of the analysis. What the results mean for the river basin, that means interpretation of the main findings. It should also include recommendations drawn from the analysis to help improve the management of the water resources in the basin. At the end, the executive summary summarizes the key points of the report. It should restate the purpose of the report, highlight the major points of the report, and describe any results, conclusions, or recommendations from the report. We have seen that the resource-based sheet provides an overview of the water resources and its current utilization per different land use categories. It looks at the gross inflow, rainfall, and incremental evapotranspiration for each of the water accounting plus land use categories, and it assesses the current utilization rate of a river basin. Key indicators provide further analysis of the situation of the water resources. The first set of indicators focuses on fraction or percentage of evapotranspiration, storage, and outflow with respect to total inflow and total evapotranspiration. The first key indicator is ET fraction, which is given by the ratio of total evapotranspiration to total inflow. ET fraction indicates which portion of the total inflow of water is consumed and which part is converted into renewable resources. A value higher than 100% indicates overexploitation or dependency on external resources. The second key indicator is stationarity index, which is given by the ratio of the change in storage to total evapotranspiration. Stationarity index is an indication of the depletion of water resources. Positive values indicate that water is added to the groundwater and or the surface water storage. Negative values indicate a depletion of the storage. The third key indicator is basin closure, which is calculated as 1 minus the ratio of outflow to total inflow. Basin closure defines the percentage of total available water resources, that is precipitation plus basin inflow, that is consumed and or stored within the basin. A value of 100% indicates that all available water is consumed and or stored in the basin. The second set of indicators focuses on the actual amount of water that is currently managed or is available to be managed. The fourth key indicator is available water, which is given as the gross inflow minus landscape evapotranspiration minus reserved flow, where landscape evapotranspiration is all water lost to evapotranspiration minus the evapotranspiration from managed land uses. It indicates the total amount of water that is available to be managed. The fifth key indicator is managed water, which is given as the incremental evapotranspiration of managed water use, which indicates the amount of water that's actually being managed. And the last key indicator is the managed fraction, which is given as the ratio of managed water to available water. It indicates the portion of managed water from the available water. Percentage of water that is actually managed from the total amount of water that is available. This is all about the resource-based sheet, the water accounting report, and key indicators. In the exercise part, you will calculate key indicators for a river basin. There is also a reading assignment. We expect you to read one of the water accounting reports we prepared for FAO using WAPOR data. Please read the report and discuss if the report contains all the basic information you expect from a water accounting report and if there are missing information. We would like to get your suggestions on what should be included in the report in your opinion. Lastly, we will post a very short questionnaire about water accounting. Now, since you are familiar with the concept of water accounting, your answers to the questions will help us to improve the usability of the output of water accounting analysis. Thank you very much for your attention and goodbye.